Hello everyone, as Peter mentioned, it's going through a bad signal patch, so in the meantime, just gonna watch the hippo with the terrapins on its back, and as soon as Peter is in a better signal area again, then we'll cut back to him on the jigger.
Signal plans are a bit longer than usual, and it's hard because of all the rain and all the leaves, and the trees are getting thicker, the habitats around us is getting lusher, more water in the leaves and the twigs. So we saw Texan on the way as well. He's also looking. Maybe some luck later on. We're going to be heading back towards Quarantine and then Gowrie Woodall. Thank you. Okay, there were some giraffe around here a bit earlier. Now, generally speaking, although you can never generalize too much, but generally speaking, giraffe are some of the easier mammals to find, since they do happen to be the tallest land mammals. Let's see if we can find them. I would also love to have some giraffe questions once we do find them. So if any of you have any questions, short or tall, start thinking of them. Let's see if we can find them first. You see them? Ach, that was too easy, Herman. Everyone, just so that you know, Herman has got his eagle eyes on. So it's not that he missed the leopard earlier, they just weren't around. He's seen the giraffe. And I'd really love some giraffe questions. I'm going to be telling you lots about them. There's, as I said, we're also talking about, in part specifically for something this afternoon. But a big part of that for me and for everyone involved is to have some questions and conversations. Oh, there's some kudus as well. Let's just sit here for now. Actually, if you look straight down the road where the giraffe just ran, if you look straight down the road where the giraffe just ran, that's actually a trickier part of a sentence than I thought it would be. If you look straight down the road where the giraffe just ran, you'll see there's a kudu bull disappearing now behind the tree trunk. Let's go a bit forward. More kudus this side as well, a bunch of females, giraffe, there's a couple of bulls up ahead. I'm also hoping that we might find that impala herd a little bit later on. I'd love nibbling always makes me think of Rexon, the way he says when he says nibbling, really sort of explains the process of carefully eating the leaves. It is still a young giraffe, which is why it's small. Look at the oxpecker right on the giraffe's tail there. Just the other day again, I heard someone talking about symbiosis and symbiotic relationships. And one of the first ones you learn about or learn about symbiosis when you start guiding is the oxpecker. Excuse me. Very bright sunlight out here. And it's because it's a brilliant example of a form of symbiosis. Let's go forward for you a bit, Edmund. But also because, bless you, bless you again. It's also because oxpeckers are a perfect example of not just any form of symbiosis, but something that's called mutualism. It's very backlit, but that looks quite nice. I wonder if the giraffe stayed where it was. Let me go forward again. Is that oxpeckers are an example of a very specific form of symbiosis called mutualism. And it is one that I do like to explain every now and again because I think it's a good one to understand, especially for those of you that are still in school or younger or even just as a principal, I think. Is that not all symbiotic relationships are necessarily good. Parasitism, for instance, is also a form of symbiosis. The one between the oxpecker and the giraffe in this case, or the oxpecker and the warthog, or the oxpecker and the buffalo, or the rhino, mutualism is a relationship where both species are benefiting. In other words, the oxpecker, as well as the large mammal, in this case, that we were just looking at a giraffe. And one of those two species is reliant or dependent on that relationship for survival. So if all large mammals disappeared, oxpeckers would disappear as well. They've developed their niche or their relationship with the environment to such an extent that they're reliant on it. Of course, all organisms in the end are reliant on other parts of the environment, water in most cases, oxygen. But this is a bit more interspecific or interspecies relationship specifically. Well, we might spend quite a bit of time here this afternoon. I'll tell you why, let me show you quickly. We're just going to do a little bit of a drive around. It's literally 10 meters this way and 10 meters that way. There's a baby impala, and I didn't actually need to move. Straight down the road. And truly one of the special things of this time of year are these little long and nimble legged little antelopes. And I want to go forward towards that impala. As we saw earlier, there's kudu around, obviously the herd of impala. We're going to see them more later on. I think as the sun gets lower, maybe in the next half an hour or so, they're going to get onto the open area, and we're going to have lots of activity from them, and hopefully the young ones will play around and run around. But the kudus, as I said, there's also some other animals here that we don't see that often, but I know that we all love very much in various forms, depending on how you look at them. One of the true characters of the African bush, the warthog. This one is determined to be behind the bushes from us. Let's just see if it's going to walk all the way past. I can see waterbuck far down the road as well. So lots of animals all together in this area this afternoon. Is the water coming out, Edmund?
Yes.
Standing still. As nice as we'd like to see him. Let's just see, he's moving. I'm going to watch the warthog a little bit. We are going to go back to the... Oh, there he's coming out. We'll go back to the giraffes just now. We'll look at the impalas. Kudu, waterbuck, lots of species together. And this is a male warthog. If you look very carefully down towards the bottom of the face, let's start up on the side first. To the side of the eyes, you'll see the big bumps there, warts, which is where the name warthog comes from. It's actually not warts, it's more calluses. And in the case of the male, if you look lower down towards the tusks, there's a second set just before the teeth, or just before the tusks. And that is indication that this is a male. Females have only got the set next to the eyes. Fairly big male, not the biggest ever, but fairly big. Warthogs can get to massive sizes. The other day I was talking to Gus in the Kalahari. They'd recently weighed one at a little bit over 100 kilograms. They couldn't weigh it exactly because the scale only went to 100 kilograms, but it was at least a few kilograms over. So they can weigh 220, 240 pounds, a big warthog. That's more than a fully grown massive leopard male, so not to be trifled with. Okay, you're getting your species recordings done. Questions there, thanks Jeanette. And William, and speaking of long legs, William, your question first, you were saying if giraffe fall down, can they get up again having such long legs? And I was just thinking of that first, because this warthog, when it turns sideways, it will look like it's got very short front legs, and it's not really the case. Warthogs are very well adapted at walking around on their, well, let's call it their knees for description's sake. It is actually more on the wrists, if you really got technical, or the ankles, if you want. It's the first joints, it's not the second ones on the leg, but gets them nice and low for the short grass or digging out roots. But William, giraffes, if they fall down, unless they break something or injure themselves or have a lion after them, often lions catch giraffe once they fall down, but if they just fall down because they slip or something happens, they can quite easily get up. They're actually quite agile for their size. Keep in mind, giraffes also lie down sometimes to sleep. And then Jeanette was asking if giraffes eat a lot, especially autumn time, in other words, holding up to winter. Yeah, I think all animals to an extent pretty much eat as much as they can. In other words, autumn time, yes, but especially now. We're just looking at these warthog, we'll look at some of these impala just now, but just looking at the surroundings, you can see it's beautiful and green. That means lots of, not only lots of food, but also lots of nutritious food. And that obviously means that the time to store up extra reserves, extra fat in the body and the muscles is now through until autumn. So yeah, I think they eat as much as they can, as long as they can. For most browsers, the toughest time is the very end of winter, even early spring, before the new leaves come out. Well, a question from someone that's just joined us. Jeremy, how's it? As we say in South Africa, hello. We were just talking about male and female warthogs, and also just quickly hello to Torsten. Nice to be able to know that we've got you on drive at the moment, and of course everyone else with you there at Oxford. Jeremy, we're just talking about the various ways of looking at or IDing or sexing warthogs, and if you look at the face, this is actually a good angle. You can see this warthog has got those two very large warts on the side of the face close to the eyes, or more calluses really. And look lower down, everyone's at, oh, we can see it there, just, you can see it there, just behind the tusks, there's a second little bump there, or a second little knob there. Only male warthogs have got those. Female warthogs don't actually have that second set of warts. They only have the top set. And then of course, as he's turning around for us, there's the sort of the typical telltale sign. We've actually got a few sort of very almost iconic African animals. There you can see a guinea fowl walking past. This is the helmeted guinea fowl. I think when people think of Africa, they obviously first think of probably first elephant and lion, or lion and elephant, one of those two orders. Giraffe, which we have just behind us here, we're going to go back to them shortly. And zebra, those are the four most iconic or associated animals with Africa. And this was actually a study done some years ago in the tourism industry in South Africa. But then things like helmeted guinea fowl and warthogs, I think, are not far behind them. If you look at the curios that people carve, if you go to various destinations where there's wooden carvings for sale, guinea fowls often feature. And I think ever since the Lion King and Pumbaa, no one will ever forget the warthog. And speaking of another character from that, Zazu, the yellow-billed hornbill, there's one that just landed in front there. Giving you a run for your camera work, Herman. Mm-hmm. Just chasing insects, I think that's why it was running so fast. Yellow-billed hornbill. In Afrikaans we call them a wurringbek, which means also a hornbill if you translate it. I love the Shanga name, the local language they call Hunkoro, referring to the sound they make. Actually in Afrikaans we also often call them kokok, also referring to the sound. Very comical birds when they run like that. Let's see if it's going to run again. It's going to fly. It's a bit difficult to show, but actually we can maybe quickly before they move too much. There's two species there, the right-hand one, the lower down one there. That's a red-billed hornbill, two different species, and the one has got the slightly smaller red bill. And the other one has got the heavier yellow bill. So that's the two different species, even though they look quite similar. So there we've got two species of hornbills all together. Oh, it's a little bit difficult to decide where to look. Just as we're sitting, things are happening right around us. We've got the hornbills, the warthog, impalas, and a big kudu bull just came walking out on the right here. Herman, let me just go 2 feet forward for you. And behind the kudu bull, we've got impalas, and slowly the young lambs, all of them less than a week or two old, are coming out as well. So we can have a whole sort of play activity from them just now. So we really do have a very special seat this afternoon. That's one, well, let's quickly count mammal species. Warthog, impala, kudu. I did see waterbuck. I can't see them now. When they come out, I'll show you again. That's waterbuck, and then the giraffe we had a few minutes ago. So five species of large mammals just around us here. And like a very good friend of mine used to always say, the light is right. We are also getting into that magic hour time of the day now. The sun is getting a bit lower. It's starting to cast longer shadows. The contrasts are getting bigger. And the light is getting beautiful. That kudu is having a bit of a scratch there. Getting that branch in behind the horns.